Okay. Okay, hi everybody.
Hi.
Okay, hi, I'm Justin from Gatai Games. Woo! Okay, I'm 1/6 of Gatai Games. I'm the design and business guy. So that's me, one of them. And then to my left, Wesley, Brian, Dexter, Andre, Weiren. So 6 guys making a really cool game. So what we're working on is a game called Stifled. It's a sound-based horror game where sound is the only way you see and the enemies hear or fear. I'm just going to show you a quick video, gameplay video, and then you guys will roughly understand what's going on. There's no audio, so... Okay, so in the game, right, when there's no sound, you're not making a sound, you don't see a thing. So everything will start going dark. Yeah. And then we have like a microphone input, so it's not shown here. Yeah. Yeah. All right, cool. So basically, as a game, you use sound to see you, and there's no sound, everything goes dark, you don't see a thing. And then we have like a microphone input, it's not really shown here. So, when in real life, right, if you make a sound, you scream when it screams, it hears you, and then, you know, it gets you. Okay, so today they asked me to come talk about VR because our game is being made to work with VR. So these are the few points I'll go through. So why did we go VR? What are the things we learned that you guys can use? And then a summary of like what we think is useful for you. Yep. Okay, so why did we go VR? Because one of the reasons is like the visuals are pretty unique. So for VR, in a sense, you can truly transport the player to some other location. And in this game, you kind of experience being blind, which is one of the reasons. We have this microphone input, which I talked about just now. So it's an additional layer of immersion. So you can see and be in the world, and then the world can hear and then interact with you. It's good marketing hype, because VR is a lot of hype right now. So that's like a very practical reason. And we thought first-person shooters or first-person view games were a natural fit, but it's not exactly the case. So we'll go through that. Yep. So Vection, this is like a buzzword in VR, which is roughly means like what you see doesn't exactly translate to your body actually moving. So it causes a lot of discomfort for players. So for first-person movement, right, when you're seeing the... Because the thing is, you're using a controller or a keyboard or mouse to move around and look, and then on top of that, you have a HMD, and you're looking around. And if you don't do it right, it's very easy to get pukish, and then it's not a very comfortable experience. We are not using these solutions right now, but these are some that we think are quite well done. So for Elite Dangerous, right, Star Citizen, I don't know. They have like a cockpit system, so the player is actually sitting inside, and you are being, how do I put it? The player understands that they are moving with the vehicle, it's not themselves, so it kind of eases that issue. Budget Cuts is like a HTC Vive game, they use teleportation, so it's like a totally different kind of movement mechanic. It's not the same as real life, so players doesn't have that vection, that kind of dissonance. Yep. Okay, so the next thing, give me a second. So anytime a camera is moving, and the player is not moving, it's actually very discomforting. So in VR, we try to avoid directed cameras, head bobbing, camera shakes. But all these things are very important for like when you're making a first-person game, you want to direct the player's attention to certain things, you want them to look at certain things at certain times. You kind of lose that ability to do that. So it's, I don't think the GIF is that obvious, but in order to simulate like camera, direct the cameras, right, we try to simulate eyes closing and opening. So you close your eyes, you teleport to the next location, you open your eyes, you look a bit, you continue, you do a few times until you finish the camera animation. We are planning to have like a intensity grading bar. So if players can take it, they can go a bit more. So the cam shakes are more apparent. If they go to zero, there's no cam shakes at all. So that's one way to do it. And we make use of like visual leading and audio because like VR is very immersive. Try to make use of like the visuals. So you look at a location, you make play a sound, use that like your leading tool instead of like, oh, I must force the player camera to look at a certain place. Yeah, so the designers need to take note of this. Okay, so because of the HMB, you can move in all the directions, right? There's a possibility of the players clipping into the environment, and that would look very weird because essentially you can see through walls. Our solution right now is when you go close to the wall, we black out the camera. So it's kind of like telling the paper, okay, you're kind of screwing the game right now, you should move back a bit. This also helps when, like, if you move out of the tracker's direction cone. So if the player's head starts to move away from the tracker, it's kind of like the note to the player, okay, you're starting to move away from the tracker, get back in kind of thing. Yeah. Okay, this is object scaling. This is one thing that we are still trying to figure out and fix as we go. It's very important because like when in VR, right, everything is super up close. You can look near, you can look far, you can bend, go under tables to take a look at it. So the items, the height, how big they are, they're all very related to real life, and then these are quite important. So our solution is like, we try to model our own office as VR, but it's still not working out that well, so we're trying to figure out how to go about fixing this. Okay, the next thing is workspace UI. Because of VR, because of depth perception, right, players' eyes no longer be able to focus so easily, because like, there's a lot of things to look at. You can't just stick stuff onto the player's camera and be like, oh, that's UI and you're fine. So important that things start to float and interact with the world. So that's an image from Google's cardboard like tutorial application. The safe distance is around 3 meters. Some people can go as close as 1.5. Currently we're using 3, it's actually still a bit too close. So we'll try to figure out what else we can do with it. The other thing is what we're using, because it's a first person game, the cursor actually moves according to depth. So if you see in the GIF, I'm not sure if it's clear. Yeah, it's like when it goes further, right, you can see that it snaps to to a further location. So that helps with the player's focus. Imagine like one thing that's just stuck in screen space in the middle of screen. It's very uncomfortable because you don't exactly know what you're looking at. Yeah. Okay, the control schemes, because we are 6 developers, right? I think most of us, because we develop quite a bit, we start getting used to control schemes that we choose. But I feel like a lot of things, because VR is very new, there really isn't like a one-size-fits-all solution. There's no like, oh, I'm going to do this control scheme and it'll just work perfectly. Because a bunch of people won't be happy with it. So for our case, we are shipping with like 2 or 3 presets that we think are correct. And we'll see what the players think and then we'll patch it from there. Okay, frame rates also is a big issue when it comes to VR, because essentially with VR you're rendering like 2 screens at much higher resolution. Because of the increased FOV, you're seeing much more as well. So lag is very obvious, because like, once you turn right, if you start lagging, you feel like your whole world is lagging, and that's like super super uncomfortable. So try optimize like crazy, and then this is something we're still testing. We're not sure if motion blur will make it worse, but we're trying out motion blur and see what happens. Cool. So this is like, after developing the game for about like 6 months to a year in VR, right? We think like, if you want to do VR, really think about VR first. Because right now, the game is like, started as a PC console game. And then we thought, oh, VR might be cool. It was cool, it is still cool. But there's a lot of problems that we need to solve because it's not a VR first title. So like the things like moving, all that kind of things, the game just doesn't play to it. Yep. And there's no rules in right now in the current VR landscape, so don't be afraid to just keep trying stuff, and then you know, if people tell you this is wrong, you try it, if it works, then you know, they're wrong. Okay, so that's the end of my talk. We're looking for testers, so drop me an email or me a tweet at that. Yeah. So my email is there, so just drop me an email, then yeah, we'll get you guys to come check it out. And hopefully not puke. Yeah. Oh man, this place is so hot. Yeah. Fuck hot, eh. Okay, questions, I'm done. Yeah.
Okay. This is just personal. Yeah. Any of your developers actually got inspiration from this manga called Till Death Do Us Part? It's like a modern rendition of Blind Samurai, and they were actually using like this.
Were you? Andre.
Okay. Read the manga, but until you mentioned it, I didn't really see the correlation.
Because that how that guy visualized the space is exactly.
It's exactly that.
Yeah, it's like audio track. Then he bounce off and did that.
I'm actually
stuff.
More surprised you didn't mention the two other very obvious things. It's very close to ours. Inception.
I think not many people know about it.
They were by ex-Bioshock there, so we thought like, God, they're out there now, we're screwed, you know?
Yeah, we are screwed.
Like, no, we're just from a small, sunny island, and then we have...
Yeah.
No, we can do best. No worry. And another suggestion is actually, I had quite a cool idea. Actually, you all can do like a bad hunter game.
Bad hunter game?
Like, you are the bad. It's like, as you stream, it's like you see your...
I think that might be the game after the next game, after the next game, after the next game. I'm so sick of Sona and echolocation right now. Yeah.
Okay, that's all.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Cool.
Yeah.
Are you guys still developing this one for PSVR or is this?
Yes. So it's PSVR. I think I met you.
Yeah. What are you going to put on the social screen? Is it going to be just the first person vision or something like that?
I think right now the social screen, we are just going to stream the same game. Yeah, because there's not much things other players can interact with. And the good thing about having it on social screen, right, is your players, your friends watching can kind of anticipate the scares and then, you know, we'll see. We hope something happens and yeah, that's currently the plan. Yeah. Yes.
So you're using a PS move to actually throw all these rocks that I see over there?
So currently we don't have a PS move. And because we don't really have the... We don't have the capacity to go into like hand controls yet, motion track controls. So right now we are just limited to the PS4 regular controller, just a regular controller. So essentially we want to make sure that it works for all the platforms. So Oculus for the Xbox One controller, OSVR for whatever controller they have. So it's just controller based right now. Yeah, it's something that I want to do, but we don't really have the time right now and the resources. So could be something we do after the fact. Yeah.
Hey, you all bump into any audio problems moving to VR?
I'm not the best person to ask because like Brian's not here. So Brian's our sound guy. But I think I believe like when we started the project, we kind of knew that we want to do VR anyway. So we always had the idea of like it always has to be 3D audio. It always has to be spatially correct. So I think on his side it should be fine. I need to check with him. Yeah, I know you love this.
I'm interested.
Yeah.
You're going from the screen to
So
your whole FOV is changed. You know?
Yes.
I need to explore like binaural audio also.
I don't know.
I'm sure it's expensive though. it's something that we thought about as well. But right now it's just regular 3D audio. Yeah, not binaural yet. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. So it's soft. I think Brian wrote his own system. So like our sound engineer wrote his own system. We tried using Wise. We were approached by Two Big Ears as well. But then the Wise wasn't as flexible as he needed it to be. And then Two Big Ears wasn't console ready at that time. So the sound engineer basically wrote his own. And it's pretty, I don't know. I'm not the programmer, so it's like, you wanna do it? Sure. Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
Who's the publisher?
Ourselves. Yeah, we're just rolling because like I'm not sure if like, that's the best idea, but let's see. I mean, for some regions right now, we are considering going with a publisher, but for Western side, we might be doing it ourselves.
Do you work with Game Station
Center? Yeah, we are working there right now. Yeah, they've been really nice. Yeah. Yep.
Which of the VR headsets or all of them are you going to map them to?
Currently, there's no confirmed list that we're going to release with, but we do have the PSVR, we have the Oculus DK2, and we have the OSVR. The OSVR is something that we haven't started doing any work on it yet, but we'll try and see what we can do. Because it's like, I think the headset isn't as well tracked as the rest, but we'll see. Yeah. Yep.
It's kind of related to this question.
Yeah.
Is there any trouble you need to do when you port between the VR sets?
Between the VR sets, I believe because Unity right now for the latest version, right, it comes natively. So once you set it up in Unity for PSVR and Oculus, it's pretty fast free to go in between these two headsets. But if I'm not wrong, the OSVR still doesn't have a native plugin yet. So that one requires more work. Yeah, so first thing is like we are at the mercy of Unity when it comes to this kind of thing. So if they come and release that, oh, it works for HTC Vive, then sure. Where's Joyce? But it's fine, yeah. So OSVR is like, we still haven't worked on it because like there's some issues, but the other two is okay. Yeah.
So you just switch the platform and everything
just... Oh, yeah, because the thing is like, for the Oculus, you're working on a PC, your optimizations doesn't need to be that amazing. It can just pass off, but for PS4 and the PSVR, you really need to optimize like crazy. And if I'm not wrong, PSVR doesn't allow you to have a streaming test set. You need to like build a whole thing then test again, and that's quite painful, but that's pretty much the same thing, I think. Yeah.
More questions?
Cool. Oh, yeah, awesome.